Well, I hope you had all had a nice break. This next segment of our event is a really fun one and what we call our research medley. And we launched this last time and it was so successful, we thought we'd do it again. It's gonna feature very short, 1 minute summaries of 10 research abstracts that we specifically selected to showcase the diversity of new research happening across our network. But before beginning the medley, I wanted to just take a few minutes to bring your attention to our research map. And I'll need the slides now, please. And which can be accessed at our website. And I'm a Macintosh user, so bear with me. I hope I can make this work. But really, you just go to our website, oshacenter.org, and that should bring you to a place where you can click on our research map. And let's say you're interested in exploring, for example, acupuncture research. So, back to our show. So if you go to oshacenter.org, it's really just one click if it's working, you can find the beginning of this entrance to our map. And let's say, for example, you're interested in acupuncture research. You simply go over to this corner here and click acupuncture. Then all of a sudden, you have a map now that just represents the acupuncture research that's happening within our network. You can then, let's say, go into this cloud of people and identify each one of these white dots is an acupuncture researcher. So some of you may know Jian Kang, who's a key researcher, and he's in the middle of this map. You can also explore it by typing in a name. Let's say you know Vitaly Napado. So you might say, what is Vitaly doing? And who is he collaborating with? So you type in his name. You click here, and all of a sudden, this map now becomes limited to, if it works, to the research that Vitaly is doing. And you can see who he's collaborating with specifically and what he's interested in. You can also go to this click here, and it'll take you right to the Catalyst website. And then you can also click here, and it will take you to PubMed, and you can find all of his research articles directly. So it's a really fantastic resource. You can go back to the map, and you can say, well, I'm actually more interested in chiropractics. You can click on this, and you get the chiropractic network, et cetera. So you get a good feel for that. And now I need to figure out how to get back to PowerPoint.
Minimize. You click out of that, and then let's hope the PowerPoint is still there.
Beautiful. Great.
But now we need to go back to the PowerPoint.
There we go. Great. So thanks for bearing with us. So we've been thinking about, in addition to creating this map, as Helena had said, is what happens when a network becomes aware of itself. So it becomes a resource for collaboration and linking. But we've also been thinking about some other ways of utilizing this. And one way is to monitor how this network has evolved over time. I'm particularly interested in Tai Chi research, for example, so we can create a snapshot of what the map looked like before 2008 or any time frame. And you can see at that time, people involved in Tai Chi research, there were 41 researchers, 11 institutions, and they had generated 43 peer-reviewed articles. If we look at what's happened since then, the map has grown substantially. We now have 108 people involved in this research network, 123 articles. We could do the same if we're interested in yoga research and look at those changes, et cetera. We can start to anchor this to initiatives. Are our initiatives really helpful? Are these tracking NIH funding patterns? Are these networks not just growing, but are they becoming more connected in diffuse ways, or are they focused around key hubs? And these are all metrics that are available. So these are some of the ways that we're thinking about using this network. So now we're going to shift back to our medley. And each of our presenters, this is a tightwire act, has precisely 1 minute. And our PowerPoint slide deck, which includes each of their presentations, is timed to change in 1 minute. So they've been coached, and I think it makes it exciting. They have a minute to introduce themselves, to summarize their poster, and entice you to visiting their poster if you haven't already, and to learn more about their work. And hopefully these preliminary findings that you see today will evolve into peer publications that will eventually be included in our map. So I want to ask you to hold your applause to the end. And then we'll give a really robust round of applause to the whole group. And I want to commend all of our presenters in advance for creating such nice slides and being willing to do this. So thank you, and looking forward to hearing this. Here we go.
Hi there. Thanks for this opportunity to present. So we all at times fail to remember important information. I'm an expert in that field of failing to remember important information. One of the main reasons that we forget is called proactive interference. It is when past memories interfere with retaining newer material. It's why we forget to enter our new password after we changed it. It's why we forget to stop by the supermarket on the way to work. It's why we call our spouse by the name of our ex occasionally. We do know that this ability is related to the hippocampus, and it is particularly relevant to older adults, people with depression, people with early life trauma. Basically, what this research, the findings of this research indicated that people, after undergoing mindfulness training, they reduced such proactive interference. So they reduced interference for past memories, and that the more they did so, the larger the left hippocampus became.
Good morning. I want to tell you a story about three studies that we're doing in response to a problem. I think we've all seen reports on the news about veterans and their inability to access care. If you survey veterans, they're very interested in alternative medicine. Most of them would like to try complementary integrative practices, but they can't get them in the VA. So just this year, we published a large-scale RCT. Acupuncture at the right dose helped with symptoms of Gulf War illness. That's published in PLOS. We're currently doing two other grants, a secondary data analysis. We put in additional measures in the parent grant to look at biomarkers as well as other survey measures, and we're looking at developing evidence for how Chinese medicine works, how complex medical illness works, and we're also currently continuing with a program evaluation with VA collaborators in order to bring the evidence that we found into the VA and other systems. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kelly Doyle. I'm an Ashtanga yoga practitioner, teacher, researcher, and I also practice general integrative psychiatry. My research project is Ashtanga Yoga Pranayama for PTSD in a veteran population. It was a case-controlled interventional study. I recruited 16 veterans screening positive for PTSD from the Durham VA Medical Center in North Carolina. All the participants were given the PCL5 and the ISI pre- and post-intervention. The intervention group received 8 total classes for 4 weeks. The intervention was a breath-based form of classical yoga called Ashtanga Yoga Pranayama for all mobility levels. At the conclusion of the one-month intervention, 8 of the 9 treatment groups scored below the cutoff for clinical diagnosis of PTSD according to the DSM-5 criteria, also below the cutoff for insomnia, compared to no significant changes in the control group. Results of this pilot study could support and strengthen existing evidence for a new effective and safe intervention for PTSD and associated sleep problems. And further inquiry could show that it is a clinically effective intervention for trauma survivors and people experiencing PTSD and insomnia. And I'm looking for future collaborators. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Sarah Collins, and I just want to thank Peter and everybody in the organization. So burnout has become a public health concern that really affects physicians, nurses, and by extension, its patients. The objective of this study was to see if brief mindfulness interventions would cause a change in burnout among diverse departments at Mount Auburn Hospital. So it was a clustered, three-armed, non-randomized pilot study, and it used 3 intervals of 30 days. We use the Maslach Burnout Inventory and the Friedbach Mindfulness Inventory as measurement tools. People could self-select whether they wanted a brief 5-minute meditation that they did independently, a facilitated small group that met for 1 hour for 4 weeks, or a delayed treatment which they were put into an intervention at a later time. The results were we found that the independent meditation had the most significant improvement in emotional exhaustion, but that the small group was also statistically important. So, thank you.
Good morning. My name is Christina Liberto. I'm a postdoc at Mass General. Enhanced resiliency is an important outcome of mind-body interventions. Our perspective is that resiliency involves the ability to bounce back in response to the chronic stressors of daily living and not just in response to significant trauma. Recently, our colleagues adapted the post-traumatic growth inventory to reflect current perceptions of functioning, and they called that measure the Current Experiences Scale, or CES. Our project explored the reliability and validity of the CES as a proposed measure of resiliency. We found that the CES reliably captured six domains of resiliency, scores were significantly correlated with other psychosocial measures as expected, and scores significantly increased from before to after a mind-body resiliency intervention. So overall, our results suggest that the CES may be a useful measure of resiliency for use in mind-body research or clinical practice. Please come see our poster for further details about the measure and the analyses and results. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Augustine Lee, a fellow from Tufts Medical Center. So why do some patients with knee osteoarthritis respond to exercise treatment while others don't? Knee arthritis is a joint disease and a leading cause of chronic pain and disability. Current pharmacological options are not very effective and they have very morbid side effects. So exercise is the first line treatment. In this study, we examined whether baseline mindfulness could predict treatment response from exercise interventions. So participants filled out the five-facet mindfulness questionnaire and other patient-reported outcomes before and after a 12-week program of either Tai Chi or physical therapy exercise. So using widely accepted criteria to define treatment response, we found that people with higher baseline mindfulness were almost 40% more likely to achieve response. This knowledge may help reduce confounding in exercise-based clinical trials and enhance the clinical decision-making process. We also infer that mindfulness cultivating interventions could be used as a preparative adjunct to increase the effectiveness of exercise treatments in this patient group. So why do some patients respond to exercise when others don't? Part of the answer may be due to their levels of mindfulness. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Sarah Olenich, and the study I'll be presenting is FASTA, which stands for Flexibility and Strength Training in Asthma. The standard of care for asthma focuses on the use of medications, with much less known about musculoskeletal factors that may contribute to asthma symptoms. In this pilot study of 10 subjects, we used a body-based treatment to address movement restrictions of the chest and shoulders as an adjunct to pharmacotherapy. Questionnaires, spirometry, range of motion, and ultrasound were used to measure physiologic changes to treatment. We saw statistically and clinically significant decreases of the ACQ, the asthma control questionnaire, and the AQLQ, asthma quality of life questionnaire, as well as a decreased use of inhaler and an increase of chest circumference. To learn more, please come see me at poster 35.
Hi, my name is Jacqueline Lutz. I'm postdoc at the Cambridge Health Alliance, but the work I'm presenting is actually done during my doctorate at the University of Zurich. So mindfulness training is thought to involve changes in the self, for example, in body awareness or equanimity towards self-evaluation. Such changes are highly clinically relevant, but neuroscientific studies in meditators and the self are rare. In two fMRI experiments on self-related processes, we compared 22 meditators and 22 matched controls. And in one task, participants perceived their body and emotions in the moment versus thinking about themselves. And in meditators, body awareness decreased prefrontal and parietal midline activations, and this pattern speaks for a successful quieting of conceptual self-related processes. The other task showed participants their previously chosen self-criticism and self-praise. In meditators, this led to increases in a prefrontal midline region related to a non-reacting attitude towards inner experiences. So not reacting to self-criticism and self-praise seemed a specific coping skill in mindfulness meditators. If you want to learn more also about the results of untrained individuals, please come and see me at my poster 29.
Good
Good morning, everyone. Acupuncture has been shown to be a minimally invasive therapy option for carpal tunnel syndrome, which is the most common entrapment neuropathy affecting the median nerve of the wrist. Although the neurophysiological mechanisms by which acupuncture impacts accepted subjective outcomes have been studied, the objective neurophysiological outcomes are not well understood. In this large randomized clinical trial, 80 carpal tunnel syndrome patients were randomized into three intervention arms: Virum electroacupuncture local to the hand, Virum electroacupuncture at distal body sites, and local sham electroacupuncture using non-penetrating placebo needles. Acupuncture therapy was provided for 16 sessions over a period of 8 weeks. While all three acupuncture interventions reduced subjective symptom severity, Virum acupuncture was superior to sham in producing improvements in both neurophysiological outcomes, local to the wrist in terms of median sensory nerve conduction latency, and in the brain digit 2-3 cortical separation distance. Moreover, there was greater improvement in interdigit cortical separation distance, which predicted long-term outcomes. So you can come check poster 30.
Good morning and thank you. I'm Rachel Rogers from Northeastern University, and this morning I'm presenting on some baseline data from a larger intervention trial of a mobile application designed to promote positive body image among adolescents that was grounded in self-compassion. The baseline data confirm that adolescents who reported higher levels of self-compassion, particularly mindfulness and common humanity, seemed to be buffered against engaging in appearance comparisons and reported higher levels of appearance esteem. This supports targeting self-compassion in our intervention and more generally of framing interventions aiming to promote positive body image and wellness for adolescents within self-compassion. We look forward to sharing the outcomes from our intervention very soon. And in the meantime, I'm at Poster 40.
That was as fantastic as we hoped it would be. So please, just one more round of applause for the whole group. So sticking with the theme of research and trying to gain a little ground in the time we lost, we're now going to showcase, and you guys are welcome to sit down. Oh, so sorry. You're not welcome to sit down. What do I know? But I'll keep going while they smile. So sticking with the theme of research, we're now going to showcase findings from four of the recent recipients of the Osher Center grants that we award to stimulate cross-disciplinary research. I'll say a few words about the competitive grant mechanisms and then introduce three of the recipients of the 2004 award who are going to do short presentations that Dan here will be timing so that they don't go over. Okay. So we have two pilot programs, and I'm going to say something about the competitive pilot program, and Helen's going to say something about the pre-doctoral award. So we offer seed grants to support collaborative projects that are consistent with the themes of the Osher Center, and these grants, as you will see, include basic translational and clinical research. Our applications undergo very rigorous review by multiple reviewers, many of them outside of the Harvard Medical School system, but experts in this field. And then final decisions are made by our committee. And the awards are in the range of $25,000 to $50,000, with up to four grants being promised for the year 2007. And the request for applications, that announcement will happen live on January 1st. And then our letter of intents are due March 1st with applications about a month or two after that. So I hope you'll go to our website and look to that information and submit a project for yourselves. So we have three awardees that are going to present today. I'll just briefly introduce them now and then let them get on with their presentations. The first award was to Dr. Gloria Yeh and Selma Holden. And Gloria Yeh, you'll be introduced to later as the head of our fellowship program, and Selma is one of our T32 fellows. And they're going to present on prenatal yoga for pregnancy-related back pain, including both clinical and biomechanical outcomes. And Selma, I think, is going to be the presenter. Our second one is going to introduce some basic research. It's Anne-Marie Zavacki, and she's from Brigham Women's Hospital, and she's going to be talking about thyroid hormones and muscles and a relationship potentially to exercise. And then speaking on behalf of Dr. Balshi and Lynn's group, which are also at Brigham Women's Hospital, is going to be Hui Jin or Vicky Liao, and she's going to be talking about measuring the effects of exercise using resonance spectroscopy. Okay, so please welcome Dr. Selma Holden up to the stage. And Dan, if you can provide our speakers with a 1 minute left reminder, that'd be great.
Right there.
Okay.
Hello, and thank you. Pregnancy is an interesting time in a woman's life where she can be motivated to do healthy behavior changes, such as increasing her nutritional choices, stopping smoking, and reduce her alcohol consumption. However, as many know, it's also a time in a woman's life where she could be inundated with a host of new physical, emotional, and mental symptoms, which can impact her overall wellness. We particularly focused on back pain because of how prevalent it is within the pregnant population, and that yoga's been shown to help back pain in the non-pregnant general population. We are also interested in factors that could create this construct of maternal wellness, such as depression, stress, quality of life, and the overall burden of pregnancy symptoms. Finally, because falls are so common in pregnancy as well, and the biomechanical forces thought to cause them overlap with some of the causes of pregnancy-related back pain, we investigated yoga's impact on gait, balance, and falls. We conducted a randomized pilot control study that was to primarily assess study feasibility, but also ask the question, do pregnant women who attend a weekly prenatal yoga class have less disability due to back pain when compared to a time-controlled group? So over at Beth Israel, we were able to randomize 20 healthy pregnant women with uncomplicated pregnancies, and they were either sent to go attend a prenatal yoga class that was an hour long over at a local prenatal yoga studio developed by a group of consensus experts, or they were randomized to attend a prenatal support group that was hour long as well, and had a facilitated group discussion which focused on topics such as nutrition, childbirth, and breastfeeding. Both groups met for at least 12 weeks, and they came in every 4 weeks to the Clinical Research Center to do a collection of validated questionnaires that investigated some of those specific aims that were mentioned previously. Additionally, we were able to do mobility testing using a wireless system where sensors were attached to their ankles, wrists, lower back, and torso, where they did walking tests. After childbirth, the women came in for a final testing visit where they did the routine questionnaires in addition to a semi-structured closing interview. So while our study was shown to be feasible, we had some inherent difficulties with the patient population. 4 of our 20 women were lost to follow-up, and our results were mixed. So looking at that primary outcome, disability due to back pain, as measured by the Roland Morris Disability Questionnaire, we found no difference between the two groups. The bold lines are the two groups, yoga in gold and the control group in navy blue. We believe that this possible lack of difference is due to the structure of the questionnaire itself. So in this questionnaire, when women are asked, because of your back pain, do you have more difficulty sleeping at night? They often responded, no, it's just because I'm pregnant in general. And so even if they did have back pain, the experience of pregnancy itself was a more substantial reason why they had difficulty putting on stockings or they needed a railing to go upstairs. So when we looked at the overall burden of pregnancy symptoms as measured by the pregnancy symptom inventory, we actually found a clear significant decrease in symptom score severity in the yoga practitioners, meaning the group in the bold yellow line, they had less overall burden due to pregnancy symptoms. Now, the pregnancy symptom inventory is a validated 41 question item that asks about a whole slew of pregnancy symptoms, ranging from physical ones, such as leg swelling and back pain, going up to more of the emotional and mental ones, such as depression and forgetfulness. So this finding suggests the claim that many yoga practitioners make, that their practice makes them feel better in a comprehensive, holistic fashion. It's not shown here, but we also found trends towards statistical difference in the depression questionnaire as well. So then when using that wireless mobility system, we also found three measurements, which I'm going to show very quickly, that showed that pregnant women seem to be more confident in their stride. The first one is we call this percent change of gait speed. So the yoga group in red at 12 weeks had a significant difference between the control group in their speed of walking, meaning that they were more confident with their stride. This has been shown in the older non-pregnant population. If somebody walks faster, they're less likely to fall. This is reinforced by the amount of time that both feet are on the ground together, so we call it double support, and also the amount of time that it took them to turn around 180 degrees when walking at a natural pace. So in conclusion, while we didn't find a significant difference in our primary outcome, we did have findings that suggest the idea that yoga reduces the overall burden of pregnancy symptoms, thereby increasing maternal wellness, and that prenatal yoga could protect the mobility and stride of a pregnant woman and boost her recovery during the postnatal period. We're really grateful to the Osher Center for this opportunity, and I just wanted to end it with one quote from a participant who did this. So, I think yoga is great because you'd spend an hour every week just kind of zenning out, I don't know, just focusing on you and your body and the baby, and you don't really get the chance to do that normally in everyday life, I don't think. I felt like it mentally prepared me a lot and gave me some really useful tools like the breathing techniques, and some of the poses were actually really useful during labor. I probably wouldn't have thought about doing yoga if it wasn't for this study, and I'm really glad that I got the opportunity to because it was really enjoyable. Thank you.
So our next speaker is going to be Anne-Marie Zivacki, and in the meantime, Helene's going to change over the slides. So.
Okay. Let's see. So I'm Anne-Marie Zivacki, and I am a basic researcher at Brigham and Women's Hospital. And today I'm going to share some of my results from a pilot grant from the Osher Center to study the novel roles of thyroid hormone activation in the muscle stem cell niche. So as everyone knows, muscle injuries are very common, and if they're accompanied by persistent pain and a loss of function or a loss of mobility, they can really affect a patient's overall quality of life. We wanted to understand how the endocrine and musculoskeletal systems are integrated so that the local changes in thyroid hormone can lead to regeneration of the damaged muscle. Of course, our overall goal is to have the best patient care possible. I'd also like to thank the Osher Center for this research grant, and also to say that the preliminary data that was generated in it was very key in my success in obtaining an R01 proposal from the National Institute of Health. Yes, thank you. That's just been funded for these studies, and we are really, really excited to learn more about how thyroid hormone works in this context. Okay, so the thyroid produces the active thyroid hormone, T3. It also produces a prohormone, T4. T4 has four iodines, which are these blue balls. T3 has three. I study the iodothyronine deiodinase enzymes, which can activate T4, the prohormone, by removing one of these iodines to produce more T3. This is important in contributing to some of the circulating levels of thyroid hormone, but also the nice thing is that it can change thyroid hormone levels within a specific cell type or a specific tissue without altering thyroid hormone levels in the circulation. So you can think of it this way. If a cell expresses this thyroid hormone activating enzyme, it'll have T3 that is in the circulation that'll be available to it that can enter. It'll have T4. T4 will be activated to T3 by removal of an iodine, and that in turn will overall change net thyroid hormone levels in the cell and increase them. This will lead to a very distinct downstream pattern of gene expression with distinct downstream effects. There are plenty of biological examples where this local conversion is important, and they range from things from proper eye and ear development to generation of heat when you're cold, and finally to muscle repair after injury, which is what I'll be telling you more about. I also have to give you a little overview of what happens when you injure your muscle. So normally the muscle has these stem cells that were sort of just quietly waiting there, and then when you're injured, the stem cells will proliferate, Then they will differentiate to new muscle cells, and finally they will fuse to form myotubes, then myofibers, which can repair the damaged muscle. Previously, we've shown that these local changes in thyroid hormone are actually important when the muscle cells differentiate, and then they're also important so that when the muscle cells will fuse to form myotubes and myofibers. The other thing you need to know is that the muscle stem cell isn't just sitting there alone in the body. It lives in a niche, and in this niche are all sorts of different cell types that are the muscle stem cell's neighbors, and they influence how the muscle stem cell will behave. We wanted to explore if, during the injury process, there was local activation of thyroid hormone in these neighbors of the muscle stem cells, and how they would affect how the muscle stem cell behaves and regenerates muscle. So I will just give you sort of two little points from my research, and I have a poster here, it's number 51, and I'd be happy to discuss these more with you later on. But so one of the things we found is that mice without the thyroid hormone activating enzyme have increased muscle stem cell proliferation after injury. So here you can see this is muscle from mice that we've injured. This is the normal mouse. This is the mouse without the thyroid hormone activating enzyme. And you can see all these little dots are nuclei, and there's one nuclei per cell. And so there's more nuclei and more cells in the mice without the thyroid hormone activating enzyme because there's more proliferation. We also found that this was due to changes in the muscle stem cell niche, not in the stem cell themselves. We're hoping someday this can help patients that have low numbers of stem cells regenerate their muscles. Secondly, when you damage your muscle, if you don't get proper repair, you get an overgrowth of fibroblasts, and you'll get collagen production and fibrosis. We found when we isolated fibroblasts from the muscle stem cell niche that when we cultured them, you would see that there was more and more, collagen production, increasing the stone by more pink staining. And we found as that was occurring, we were also getting an increase in the thyroid hormone activating enzyme. And we think this local generation of T3 is leading to collagen production and leading to the fibrosis process. Again, we're hoping someday we can understand this more and use this to treat patients with fibrosis. We're also going to explore if some of these changes that we're seeing might be targets and things that are changed during the beneficial effects of stretching. So I thank you for your attention, and I thank the Usher Center for supporting this research.
And our final presenter today is going to be Vicky Liao.
Hi, everyone. So we first want to thank you, Osher Center, for giving us this pilot grant. So different studies have shown that Tai Chi is a mind-body exercise that gives physical benefits to the elderly, such as improvement in cognition and also improvement in muscular fitness and muscular strength. The goal of this study is to measure and quantify the physiological changes that the brain and muscle undergo during Tai Chi training by using MR spectroscopy. In this pilot study, we recruit 6 elderly subjects, 5 female and 1 male. All subjects were Tai Chi naive, who have not done any Tai Chi training within the last 12 months. They all participated in our 12 weeks Tai Chi training. And the Tai Chi trainings took place at the Greater Boston Golden Age Center. They practice at least 2 times per week, and each practice is 45 minutes. We acquire a scan before and after their 12-week Tai Chi training. So in each pre- and post-training scan, we acquire 2 types of MRS scan. So the first one is the proton brain scan, and the second one is the 31 phosphorus muscle scan. We have done both in the same scanner, but not simultaneously. So in the 31 phosphorus muscle scan, we have the subject exercise inside a MRI machine, as you can see in the picture here. So we acquire the data at rest, doing exercise, and we also watch the recovery of a chemical in muscle in real time. So as you can see here, we set up an exercise device inside an MRI magnet, and I can tell you it really works out your muscle because I've done it myself. And then after that, so it will be the brain scan, and then the subject turns around, and then we will scan the brain metabolism. So we acquire data in the posterior cingulate, which is a reflect of the global brain health in that region. So the chemical that we measure in the muscle is the phosphocreatine. So phosphocreatine is used by the muscle to make energy. And after exercise, your muscle will make more. So after they use up in the exercise. So the better shape your muscle is in, the faster it repletes the phosphocreatine levels. So in the results here, there are 5 out of 6 subjects show a faster phosphocreatine recovery rate. So you can see like there is significant difference between the pre and post training scans. And here on the upper left corner is the example proton brain spectrum. So we see a significant difference in NAA to creatine ratio among all the metabolites, because MR spectroscopy was able to measure other metabolites as well. So similarly, we found 5 out of 6 subjects show an increase NAA to creatine ratio, and 1 show a small change within the variability. So NAA, N-acetyl-aspartate, produced in neurons and transport down axon, it's a marker of neuronal and axonal density. The concentration of NAA reflects the functioning axons, number of functioning axons in the brain. So as you can see in this picture, the gray picture here, so it's a beautiful pictures of NAA staying dendrite. So an increase in NAA to creatine ratio indicates that Tai Chi chaining may promote neuronal growth. So in summary, this pilot study showed the feasibility of MR spectroscopy on measuring the effect of Tai Chi chaining. And most of our subjects show improved phosphocreatine recovery rate and also increased NAA to creatine ratio after 12 weeks of chaining. So which indicate that Tai Chi chaining may improve brain and muscle health in the elderly. So with these exciting findings, we hope that more funding resources can support and a larger cohort can be recruited for this study. At the end, I want to thanks my PI, Dr. Alexander Lin, who unfortunately was not able to attend and give the presentation today. And I also want to thanks everyone in my lab who make different contribution to this study. And thanks OSHA give this pilot grant. Thank you.
So that was a fantastic round of presentations from our previous recipients. And before we move on to our final presenter, I wanted to just introduce the lists of the recipients of our 2016 awards. And maybe this will start to whet your appetite and think about what your application might be starting in January for the 2017 program. But Amit Anand and his team from BIDMC were funded to do a study of pranayama or integrated yoga and meditation for sleep apnea. Olivia Okirke who's in the Division of Preventive Medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital and also at the Channing Lab, are going to look at a really nice epidemiological study looking at the relationship of DNA methylation and other markers using the Women's Health Study, a large epi study. Zev Shulman-Olivier and Gail DeBoers, I believe I saw Gail here earlier, from Cambridge Health Alliance and MGH were funded to look at neural and physiological effects of self-compassion and chronic pain. Carrie Bernstein from the Osher Clinic in neurology, along with her team, are going to be looking at migraines and chiropractic care. And then Maria O'Donnell, and in partnership with Dr. Paulson, as I mentioned before, are going to be looking at MBSR for diabetes. So please join me in congratulating them and receiving their awards. So now Helene's going to say a few words about the pre-doctoral award and introduce our final speaker.
So I'm very pleased to now introduce the first winner of our pre-doctoral fellowship Integrative Medicine Award. So this is very special for us because there's been a kind of a theme we mentioned earlier. We really believe it's very, very important that integrative medicine is not just bringing complementary and alternative practices together with conventional medicine. It's also really understanding the connections that exist within a person, is treating a person as a whole, not just separate body parts. And one of the important things is that organ systems are typically studied in isolation from each other. And so we wanted to encourage basic PhD students who are in a basic science, like a cell biology or molecular biology project, to think about how would their project translate across different systems of the body. This is not an easy thing to ask. We also wanted, so the requirements for this is an award that's offered for PhD students. They must be a part of the Integrative Life Sciences Graduate Student Umbrella Program at Harvard. The award is for $10,000 a year, renewable for 3 years, plus some traveling stipend. And so the project is required to not only include relevance to a cross-system and translational integration, sort of across, starting from, say, a very simple system, like a cell, and then move into more complex systems, but also to create a new collaboration that their lab wasn't previously collaborating with. So we were very fortunate to have our candidate who met all of these criteria in spades, is Ilya Drutanin, and his study is of cross-system physiological integration through high-throughput identification and analysis of Drosophila melanogaster, mouse and human, so he's just going up the chain, inter-organ communication secreted factors. We need a slide switch.
Thank you, Aileen, for the nice introduction and also for inviting me to speak today. My name is Ilya Druzhinin. I am a graduate student at the Department of Genetics at Harvard Medical School, and my work focuses on the identification and characterization of novel factors mediating communication between organs. Organs are highly specialized and integrated. For example, nutrients are taken up by the gut, travel to liver and adipose tissue where they're processed and released through the periphery to act, for example, on the skeletal muscle for contraction, for the brain, for behavior. And also, organs are highly dependent on each other. For example, in the case of increased muscle contraction, nutrients will be released more from the adipose tissue and liver to give energy. And because of these connections, organs, there exist factors, for example, protein factors that act between organs to coordinate function of them. One example is leptin. For example, leptin is produced in response to fat sensing and acts on the brain to affect feeding behavior, and insulin, which is produced by the pancreas to control metabolically distal organs. And these are the type of factors, especially protein factors, we are interested in investigating. The model system we are using is Drosophila melanogaster, or the fruit fly, and we are using it for its first array of genetic tools. We could very quickly discover novel factors involved in these processes. Also, Drosophila has a number of organs functions that are similar to humans. For example, the nervous system, the muscle, the fat body, which is similar to the adipose tissue in humans, the digestive system, reproductive system. And also in the flies, nutrients enter the gut and go to the fat body where they're processed and stored and then released to the periphery. Also, there exist factors that function between organs. For example, UNPAIR2 is the fly ortholog of leptin. Leptin is UNPAIR2 is sensed by fat or sugar levels, acts on the brain, where in the flies the insulins are produced, or the DILPs. They act on the peripheral organs to mediate growth and metabolism. The real reason we are using the flies is that we can do high-throughput genetic screens to very quickly identify organ communication factors. Such screens have not been performed before for this purpose, but what we have been able to do is mutate 1,000 secreted factors in each of 4 different organs using a powerful Gal4-US system where we knock down, using RNAi, specifically in one organ, and then look for effects in another organ. Using this study, we were able to come up with an interorgan communication network in which different components act between organs, for example, muscle and gut, fat body and ovary, and many others. I should say some of these factors we're also able to find in the fly blood or the hemolymph using high throughput mass spectrometry. And many of these factors have human orthologs, suggesting that such connections may exist in humans. To give you an example, we find this factor called CG9796, which seems to inhibit intestinal stem cell overproliferation. For instance, on the left you can see the wild-type fly gut, which does not show much stem cell mitosis, which you would see in red, and blue is the nuclei. On the right, you can see if you knock down CG9796 in the muscle, you get a huge increase in gut size, as marked by white, and an increase in number of stem cells. You can see these red dots. There's about a 6-fold increase. So the model from just from this is that we can... Perhaps the muscle produces CG9796, which acts on the gut to inhibit intestinal stem cell proliferation, almost in like a tumor suppressor role. And we find this factor also in the fly blood by mass spectrometry, and there exists a human ortholog for which secreted function is not known. In conclusion, we have used such organ sensing screens to identify and validate previously uncharacterized conserved organ communication factors. And we are currently in the process of examining mechanisms and functional conservation in mammals. And with this, I'd like to close and thank people who have helped me with the project, especially Norbert Perelman, who's my advisor, and the funding, especially Osher, for the nice opportunity to do this kind of research. Thank you.
So I'd like to now introduce Dr. Gloria Ye, Dr. Gloria Ye is at the BIDMC in the Department of Medicine, and she's a professor of medicine, and associate professor of medicine, excuse me, and she's also the director of the T32 fellowship program, postdoctoral fellowship program in integrative medicine, and Dr. Ye will give out the prizes for the best poster, 2 best poster presentations.
All right, great. So I have the distinct honor and pleasure to introduce and to announce the 2 best poster awardees. So these prizes came with $500 for first prize and $250 for second prize. And in keeping with the theme of the conference, we have both a clinical poster as well as a research poster. So I'll announce the second prize first. The second prize goes to Dr. Weidong Lu, who's the lead oncology acupuncturist at the Zacum Center. His poster is entitled Oncology Acupuncture Practice for Cancer Symptom Management at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. Thank you. And our first prize goes to, I hope I say the name right, Ishtiak Mala, a research assistant at the Martino Center for Biomedical Imaging at Mass General Hospital. His poster entitled Rewiring the Primary Somatosensory Cortex in Carpal Tunnel Syndrome with Acupuncture. I just also wanted to just acknowledge everyone, all the contributions for the posters to really honor everyone's creativity and innovation. So thanks and congratulations.
Okay, the person who lost their cell phone, the cell phone is now ringing. So, oh geez. Thank you. All right, moving right along. I may need the AV help for it because I'm going back into the network presentation here, so we'll see if it works. So, as I announced before, we are now inaugurating our clinical integrated medicine clinical network map. So just like Peter gave you a demo of the research map, I'm going to show you now how the clinical map works. But also importantly, I want to just say that this map was done by a company called Exaptive. And it is a wonderful company that specializes in network visualization. So it's no good. The nice thing about networks is that you can see them. And it really brings to life. It's so much better than just seeing a list of people. When you see how they are, how they are organized, how they relate to each other, it's a much, much more informative. And we have here Mr. Clive Higgins, who is a representative of Exaptive, who's in the foyer. He has a demo screen, so during the lunch, you're more than welcome to go and see him, and he can help you play with the map, and also we can also use it using your mobile phones. So basically, this clinical map, the way it's organized is a little bit different from the research map in that we wanted to make sure that the modalities were represented in a very integral part of the map. So here, basically, I'm just going to go into the live map now, but I just wanted to show you on the static image of it what it looks like. So you have all here, these are all the clinicians that are represented on this map are all clinicians who have an affiliation with an academic institution somewhere in Boston. So that's the criteria for being on the map, is that you need to do some work that's related to integrative medicine, and you need to have some kind of academic affiliation. So right now, we are showing 22 such centers. So these little blue icons here are all the centers that do some kind of integrative medicine service. And these icons here, the big icons, represent can you see my mouse? Yeah, the academic institutions of Mass General, Dana-Farber, Brigham, Spalding, et cetera. And with a total of 92 total clinicians. So that's quite a bit, but we're convinced that we're just starting to scratch the surface here. We're convinced that this map could probably just double if we knew where all these people are. So one of the goals that we have here right now, today, is to hopefully a lot of you who think you should be on this map, if you qualify, need to register. And we'll show you how to do that. So now I will, ta-da, hopefully, go on the map. Yay. It takes a few seconds. We see these little dots. So this map is accessible from our website. So you go to oshacenter.org. On the home page, there's a link to the clinical map. So here it is. So I'm just going to demonstrate a couple of features of this map. The first thing is if you wanted to know, for example, where is acupuncture being performed at one of those institutions? So you see here, this is acupuncture here. And these are all the centers that are performing the acupuncture. So these are 15 centers that perform acupuncture. And what this will tell you here, this menu, will tell you what these centers are. And if you click on one of these centers, you will go to the center's website, okay? A little bit like what the research map did. And then all of the clinicians that are listed here, these are the total clinicians through these centers. These people don't necessarily all do acupuncture, but if you scroll down, you will see what they do. Like, for example, here, this one, Allison Blaisdell does acupuncture. So you can tell. But in the future, we're going to try to make it even more specific than that. The other way you can use the map is you can say, okay, what's going on, say, at Mass General? So if I click on Mass General, I can drag the Mass General out here and see what's going on. And I can see the centers. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 centers that are affiliated with Mass General. I can see the clinicians. And then these balloons here tell you what they do. So massage therapy, yoga, Tai Chi. So these are all the services that are offered at Mass General. And you can also search. If you click outside the map, it'll deselect what you've selected. You can also type somebody's name here and find that person if you think so. We'll type Dr. Levy. There he is. And so Dr. Levy is right here. So you can now click on Dr. Levy and see where he is. So he's at the Osher Center, and he's at the Brigham. And then if you want to deselect Dr. Levy, you do this. Sometimes the map stays ghosted, but it shouldn't. So anyway, if you want to register for the map, you click here on this button, and let's see if that can work. Actually, I'm going to show you that a little bit later. So we'll save the registration for later. I'm going to close this. So we're now going to move into the clinical medley, which I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Levy, who you already know. And this is going to illustrate some of the clinical services that are embedded in the academic institutions that we just talked about.
I've been a clinician for 35 years, and I love practicing clinical medicine. I love practicing clinical integrative medicine. And I also think that the basis of my practice improves tremendously when there's good research. So this is a wonderful type of conference where you're seeing both sides of that. Now we're going to have a chance to have people speak with four minutes or less about their center. And every person, the four people that you're going to meet, have either founded and or directed or managed a center in the Boston area that does some kind of integrative health care. And the other thing that they have in common is they all have an affiliation with Harvard Medical School, which has its opportunities and its challenges. So we'll hear from each of them. Is the slide? Where's the? That's good. They've been asked in 4 minutes or less, and this gentleman's going to tell you when it's 1 minute to go. These three questions, where does your clinic or clinical program fit in your institution? What challenges have you faced in building your program? That could be an hour, I'm sure. Share a lesson learned or some kind of clinical pearl. So I'll ask Dr. Guy Pugh. He's the medical director at the Marino Center for Integrative Health in Cambridge. It's affiliated with Mount Auburn Hospital. It's a freestanding multi-service clinic, and I know it well.
Thank you. I don't have any slides. Don asked, it was very nice of Don to ask me here today. I was very honored by that. The first time he made me an offer like that was when he said, "Do you want to be the medical director of the Marino Center?" That was in 1999. And he made me an offer I couldn't refuse because he was the current director. So he then wandered over here. But he called me a couple months ago and made me another offer I couldn't refuse, which is to talk here today. The Marino Center has been in existence since 1996. It was founded as originally basically focused on EDTA chelation, nutritional therapy, and some alternatives. And quickly, within a couple of years, became a primary care-centered center. It was run as a nonprofit. It briefly had two centers. For a little while, it actually had a third, but the second center was in Wellesley. And then took its final form about 3 years ago when Mount Auburn Hospital purchased the Cambridge Center. Newton Wellesley purchased the Wellesley Center, and that's got us to where we are today, which is a primarily primary care-centered center, as I said. We have five primary care physicians. We have two nurse practitioners who do women's health. We also have mental health services, that is a psychiatrist, psychopharmacologist, rheumatologist. We have acupuncture, massage, chiropractic, and traditional Chinese medicine and some other services at different times. But that's basically the model. But the basic model is that most of the patients that come to the center are primary care patients, which is not the way every center works. What differentiates us between our center versus other primary care centers, I think primarily, if you really look at it, it's that we have long appointment times. We spend a lot of time with our patients. People typically get an hour for the first appointment, typically get half an hour to 45 minutes for follow-up appointments. We offer these CAM offerings at the center under one roof, and we have some functional medicine that's sort of done within the context of each individual appointment, and then also some things like IV services and things that some of our practitioners do. So that makes us different. We have all those services under one roof. It makes us a little different. Now, surprisingly, now that we're part of Mount Auburn, we can see how we fit into the big picture by comparing our performance to other primary care centers. And the funny thing about it is that we're not that different. The productivity, for instance, of each of the primary care doctors is really about the same. There's a lot of overlap with so-called high output, you know, input, output, 20 patients a day, at least that's what they always say. We may have a total of 8 or 10 patients a day, and yet somehow the numbers come out at the end of the day about the same, so I don't know exactly why that is, but that's part of it. There's a couple of other differences, though. One is that our panel sizes tend to be a little smaller because we have fewer patients. That reflects in some of the incomes as we have these models increasingly that are based on panel sizes. Those of you who are primary care know that there are these different trends. Another interesting observation is that our patients don't seem to be as sick as the regular patients in the rest of the population in Cambridge. And we know that by things like these risk-adjusting diagnoses that we're commanded to continuously give our patients. We're constantly pressured to make our patients more sick so that we get more reimbursement. But we try our best. We can't seem to make them sick. They seem to constantly be in a state of health that we can't seem to shake them out of, which is very bad for our bottom line. Since I only have a minute left, the challenges, biggest challenge to us as a primary care center that does alternative and complementary medicine is that we are a primary care. The challenges to primary care these days are phenomenal and horrific. If anybody is doing primary care, they know what I'm talking about. There's meaningful use. There's the ACA. Love Obama. Don't always love everything about the ACA. There's the pressures of the electronic medical record. There are the pressures of doing more and more with each visit that we have in primary care. This has created a situation where our focus as a group tends to be more and more on things that are away from our mission. You know, we have to have special sessions to learn more about electronic medical records as we transfer to Epic, for example. It's a huge change for us. That takes away from our clinical conferences that we get to, as we get together, which is what I'm going to say about this sort of clinical pearl. I think the things we wish that we could do more often, or that we could do more, is that we could expand our offerings, have more stress reduction classes, yoga classes, group visits of various kinds. Also that we could have better, and we're seeing some of these things already, but better collaboration with Mount Auburn Hospital that owns us so that we could work with, and we're starting to, with oncology and with the employee programs, a bunch of different possibilities to work with the hospital. And then the last is to preserve our culture. A lot of the people at the Marino Center have been there from the very beginning. They've been there 20 years, 25 years, and we've found that if you meet together and if you eat together, you tend to stay together in some way. And we really struggle to make that sacrosanct time every week where, as a group, we share ideas, share values, and maintain a core of an institution that is the Marino Center and its values. And that's the real challenge, as we have so many pressures from other places. So I'm happy to answer questions later. I guess it'll come up. But thank you very much.
Irene Martinyuk is a licensed acupuncturist, and she's the program manager for acupuncture and massage therapy at the Catherine A. Gallagher Integrative Therapies Program at Mass General, correct? Yes, by the way, correct. At the end, we'll have a few minutes, and all four of them will sit here, and you can ask some questions.
Hi. And how do I go forward? Just enter the space bar. Okay, great. Excellent. So the Catherine Gallagher Integrative Therapies Program is a program of the Mass General Cancer Center. It's a really interesting contrast from Mr. Pugh's program, since we're very specific to a disease center. We provide the vast majority of our services in the treatment areas while patients are undergoing treatment. So the clinician, rather than having a building, the clinicians go to the patients. So the clinicians go to the infusion unit, for example, while the patients are receiving chemotherapy or another infusion. We also have services adjacent to the radiation therapy center, so patients can immediately before or immediately after the radiation therapy appointment come for acupuncture, massage therapy, a music therapy, or an art therapy session. Those are the clinical interventions which are in the treatment centers. We also have care at the bedside on the dedicated oncology floors. So there are currently 3.5 dedicated oncology floors. So we receive a consult from the medical team just as any other supportive care service would receive a consult. The vast majority of our clinical services are funded by philanthropy, which makes us very fortunate but also really limits us. We have made the decision to really focus on access to care for all our patients. So the services provided in the treatment areas are no charge to patients. So it's included as part of their care. It's no charge to them or their insurance company. The limiting factor is that it's only available to patients while they're receiving treatment. Once they transition out of treatment, we do have a fee-for-service clinic, but many patients find that not affordable. So, which gets us to the reimbursement question, which I think is an issue for everybody, that because our services are funded by philanthropy, we have sort of a finite amount of services we can provide. Our goal is to be fully integrated into the medical practices, into the clinical practices, but we don't currently have the, I hate the word bandwidth, but it's bandwidth. We have what we have, and because we're not billing, we're limited to what we can provide, which leads to frustration among the patients and the medical providers. Many of the physicians in our practices are referring patients as soon as they are diagnosed. So as part of the multidisciplinary teams, they want to incorporate integrative therapies. However, we don't have the ability to meet all the needs. We have waiting lists for, I think all of our clinics have waiting lists for initial visit. So I think a really important part of our success has been that we are under the medical oncology practices. Our director is the director of clinical services for the Cancer Center. So we are linked with that, with the medical, the established medical system. Thank you very much. And the clinical pearl I wanted to talk about is actually more of a building program or building alliances pearl. Because we're embedded in the treatment areas, when we come into a new setting, we are affecting the workflow of all the clinicians in the area. So when we planned and implemented new services, we met with everyone, the medical assistants, the schedulers, the people at the front desk, because all of these people are potential allies or potential people whose job we're making more difficult because we're adding a service and they already have a lot to do. So they were involved from the get-go with planning the program and then with determining any changes that if there was something that was affecting their workflow, we worked with them to try to accommodate those needs. And they had some terrific suggestions for how to increase access for patients. So really, and I know leadership, the physician leadership and the administrative leadership is critical. We wouldn't be here if we didn't have that support. But I think all too often, the clinical and support staff at every level is not recognized to the extent it should be for the importance of their role in bringing patients to us.
Dr. Eric Leskowitz is the director, is the program manager, right, for the director of the Integrative Medicine Task Force at Spalding, which has several locations in the Boston area. He's a pretty experienced clinician himself.
Thank you. Appreciate the opportunity to talk here. It's really amazing to see how the field has grown so much in the last 20, 30 years. Did you do that? Okay. So let me just give you a little background about our program. The red flyer is from 1999. The second annual conference, the first Harvard-sponsored mind-body conference in Partners Hospital was our complementary and alternative medicine rehabilitation. So we've been doing it for a while. It's an outgrowth of the chronic pain management program, which I'll talk about in a second. But just to show you that we've been focusing on education of providers, the glowing gentleman in the middle there is Ram Dass, who's a well-known spiritual teacher who suffered a stroke, spent a day with us talking to patients, staff, and the community about about spiritual aspects of living with a stroke. In the lower right-hand corner, highlights our emphasis on caring for the caregiver, healing the healer. We've organized and hosted a number of those conferences over the years because, as you all know, it's there's a high risk of burnout. Integrative medicine has a lot to offer. The shiny new building in the middle is our new hospital, and it's state-of-the-art and environmentally sensitive and all, but it's a mixed blessing, and I'll talk about that in just a sec. Just to go to the three focus points. As I mentioned, we started as a pain program over 40 years ago using things like biofeedback and exercise to help with chronic pain. We were an inpatient unit at that time. Its integrative approaches spread to other parts of the hospital, and now throughout our network, we've in the era of hospital consolidation, we've become 3 inpatient hospitals and over 20 clinics. Our unique approach was to use standard credentialed providers, physical therapists, nurses, doctors, who also had expertise in these integrative approaches, and that was established our credibility from the start. We've now grown to over 100 providers throughout the network on our integrative medicine task force list. Just some sample programs that are blossoming now is yoga, adaptive yoga for rehab patients. We have specialized programs for amputees, for neuro patients, for community members. That's called Yoga for the Unfit and Inflexible, which is a applies to a lot of people. We have mindful low back pain yoga and chair yoga, and there's a poster presentation by one of our physical therapists, Urvashi Chogal, upstairs about that. We're also working on a new burns adapted yoga. So that's an area that has a lot of potential. We have a very active volunteer Reiki program and have given over 2,100 treatments in the last 3 years. And what I find most impressive is that throughout the network, over 35 clinical staff have been trained in Reiki up to level 2. That's just phenomenal change from the olden days. Acupuncture and massage, the same challenges that some of the other providers have talked about. Not all that many people can afford self-pay. We've had some foundation funding for pilot studies, but that would be our goal, to have more resources available to make these really, really helpful treatments available. Within the Department of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, or PM&R, we're now collaborating with the Young Stroke Wellness Program and with the Neuromodulation Lab. And there's also a poster presentation by Leon Morales Cruzada from the lab on placebo factors that's also upstairs. In terms of the challenges, one of our main handicaps was me, that I'm a psychiatrist rather than a physiatrist. And the difference in departments, we were kind of siloed off, and it took a long time to build some of those bridges. The hospital didn't really understand what CAM was, a notorious memo from the CEO. After I'd given a presentation on therapeutic touch, non-contact Reiki, he wrote back a 3-point memo saying, we were forbidden from using treatments that did not involve contact. So non-contact was not allowed. We were not allowed to use magnets, which I hadn't even mentioned, and which would knock out the whole neuromodulation lab. And we were not allowed to use intuition. I came really close to responding by saying, I had a hunch you were going to say that, but I didn't. So the new building has been our number one fundraising priority, and it's diverted a lot of funds, but it's a new era now, and I think things are ready to blossom. The time pressure on staff, you all face that too. People are too busy to take 10 minutes out of their schedule to get a mini massage, so we're working on ways of overstaffing that the Cape Cod Hospital has developed. Couple of quick pearls. It's about cultural change, and I think it's a grassroots process. And I'm most inspired by the fact that the doctors, the young trainees, are embracing this. I've known for years that nurses and physical therapists and allied professionals, they get it. But to see the doctors finally getting it is really inspiring. And so I guess the motto would be for integrative medicine, if you offer it, they will come. And that's what we're trying to do. Thank you.
The next presenter, and then we'll all sit for a few minutes for questions, is Stacy Lee in LICSW. She's co-founder of the Wellness Works at the Parkinson's Disease and Movement Disorders Clinic at the Beth Israel Deaconess in Boston.
Good afternoon, I guess it is now. My name is Stacy Lee. I'm the co-founder of the Wellness Works for Parkinson's program at BIDMC. My partner is the Movement Disorders Center in the Department of Neurology, which is now headed by David Simon. And the clinical head of the program is Lisa Kappas, who is a social worker. So where does your program fit into your institution? Wellness Works is going to its eighth year of life. It evolved from my personal experience as a patient with Parkinson's disease, where when I first became symptomatic 9 years ago, there was no treatment offered to me upon diagnosis other than medication and a follow-up visit in 6 months. I was not happy. I intuitively knew moving my body was a good thing because I had been really ill for about a year before I was diagnosed and could barely move. Though at the time that I was proposing this to the hospital, there was no research to support the importance of movement. There is now, of course. I felt strongly that we needed high-quality programs in Boston, and I enlisted the help of Dan Tarsi, then head of the Movement Disorders Center, to create a program. We started with a Zumba class and now offer boxing, Tai Chi, a joint program with Peter Wayne, Brigham and Women's Hospital, yoga, boot camp, and golf. A key element to the service is that a social worker makes contact with all new patients to review their circumstances and to help design a treatment plan, to take a look at the whole person. Unique is our training of teachers and inclusion of care partners in the classes that we hold. What are the challenges? Happily, the department director, Dan Tarsi, the neurologist, social worker, and nursing were all interested in the idea when I proposed it a long time ago now. The hospital was willing to be flexible with staffing and agreed to shared positions, as we did not need nor could afford full-time staff. Also, the hospital was becoming culturally interested in wellness and prevention programs, which helped a lot. I'd say the greatest challenge, which no surprise, was funding. I came with some money and I had held fundraisers for several years to really build the money that was devoted to the program. In my opinion, this kind of effort, when you have a charitable effort, requires someone or ones to bring financial resources. It also was really important to me, which I didn't expect, to stay on top of how money was spent. In a large institution, money disappears, things get on your budget that you don't belong to you. Nobody tends to look at that. My dad taught me how to do that when I was 8 years old, and I'm still doing it. So I insist on looking at the budget every year, line by line, and have found plenty of mistakes. Another challenge for us is referrals. Even though the doctors supported our efforts, very much so, for the first couple of years, most of the referrals came through social work. And I have an idea why that happens, and we can talk about that if people are interested. Programs over time have sold themselves, especially the latest craze, which is boxing for Parkinson's, which comes from the Midwest. We now have a listing of over 600 interested participants in our programs. In terms of clinical pearls, I would say two stand out for me. One is to invest. If you have a program like this, you need to invest in your teachers or clinicians. You have to pick good ones and offer training and input. At the time we created our programs, nobody knew how to do specialized programs for Parkinson's, so we had to be very creative, sometimes had teachers from out of state, sometimes learn together, cross the city in order to find teaching resources for us, and learn. And we learned as we went. The teachers, I have learned, are the essential motivators and healers in our programs. And then the other thing, which I should have known because I'm a social worker, but didn't give enough credence to, is the importance of the community that you build. We underestimated that. The members of the classes educate and support each other like nobody's business. I have never seen anything like the connection between the people in our classes, and what they have done for each other often brings tears to my eyes when I'm in the classes. I am frequently told by patients that we have changed their lives, and they have changed each other's lives. So that's what I have to say. I have one comment, though. Always a comment. Bringing together Boston clinicians, researchers, educators, and patients.
Thank you. If anyone has questions, here's a chance, please. We only have a few minutes, but we were hoping for as much audience participation as possible. Is anybody out there that wants to add? Wait, get them all settled. Yes.
Deep breath. My name is Elisa, and I represent Heart Intelligence Research Institute. Actually, our topic is research about connection, cardiovascular dysfunction, and ability to love, to enjoy. And our main challenge is when people listen to our recommendation. Like, they are really simple, and I do believe a lot of people here really think the same. Like, eat simple, healthy food, meditate, increase the level of your exercise, of your physical activities. And people say, yeah, sure, it's good, I'll do that. But when I see someone smoking on parking lot, I really think, oh, it's so important not just to talk to them, but some kind of, I cannot say control, but at least check, do they really do that? Do they really feel the same about how important it is to keep doing it on daily basis? And I want to ask you, that's actually my question, how do you check, are your patients keep doing your life-changing habits, and how do you encourage them to keep, don't lose their courage and don't lose their motivation? Thank you so much. Thank you.
Whoever wants to jump in.
Psychiatrist.
You're allowed to use intuition.
It's nice to be treated with some respect. Usually psychiatrists are most stigmatized. But I think that we build up a good head of steam because we have a group program. So patients are in a group of five or six people, and they stay connected. We make sure to link them up to community programs. We have after therapy fitness group and other after program, it's an 8-week program, after program venues, and we stay in touch with them that way. We're working on setting up an ongoing pain support group as well, but I think our job was to sort of get them awakened and get the head of steam going and then let them go.
I think it's important to acknowledge how difficult it is to change, and that when patients look at the menu of things that they need to be doing differently, it's completely overwhelming. So one of the things I try to ask patients is, can you change one small thing today? Is there one thing that you can change? And usually people can identify one thing they can do. Well, even I'm going to go home and I'm going to have dinner. You know, something as simple as that for someone who's who has irregular meals or who skips meals or who isn't feeling well. I've been meaning to go to this meditation class. I'm going to take the time to go. And I can't, you know, I'm not going to change my diet. I'm not going to stop working my stressful job. Like, I can't do everything, but this is one thing I can do. And then with the oncology patients, we have a treatment plan. So we do follow up because we're seeing people regularly. So we have an opportunity to develop a relationship over time and then and check in.
Why don't we... Wait, we're short of time. If you could keep your question real short, get right to the point, maybe we can get a few more in. You want to go?
Eric Rosine, Boston Medical Center. There are some conditions like back pain where A number of integrative therapies have been shown effective in clinical studies and recommended by clinical guidelines, yet whether or not a therapy is reimbursed seems to be a huge driver for whether a patient may receive it or not. How do you guys triage patients in your system, and how do you think integrative medicine fits into payment reform?
Well, it's a big challenge. We've actually had fairly good luck getting coverage. We used to be an inpatient program, but that got nixed. So in the outpatient setting, physical therapy and occupational therapy administer most of the treatments. For psychotherapy, you can get a lot under that umbrella. I use the tapping EFT acupressure protocol, and it's another form of psychotherapy. Probably don't tell Blue Cross because my wording is skillfully adjusted. But there are ways to use biofeedback as neuromuscular reintegration, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a challenge. Acupuncture and massage, it's harder to get the coverage for.
Yeah, I would say that. I would echo that. Yeah, I think it's very difficult to just, I often lay out the possibilities for a patient, say you could do any number of these things. Chiropractic may be covered. Physical therapy will probably be covered. Other things I think are terrific, but you're going to have to think about the price and other things, and it's going to be your journey trying to figure out which of these things really works out. I think that the Osher Center sort of specializes in back pain, and how do you guys figure out?
Same problems that you're talking about, exact same problems. Which things are covered are often chosen first, even though we might prefer something else. They have chiropractic coverage, or maybe they're, for some reason they have acupuncture coverage, so they'll go there first. And especially, unless they have a lot of money and can spend it right then.
Especially functional medicine and supplements and things like that are hugely expensive, unfortunately.
You want to try it? Yes, short. Short question.
So my question is related to the question that was just asked. And specifically, I think it most resonated with Irene's work with oncology patients. And I'm wondering if there is space for clinical practitioners to, you know, there's this emerging field of holistic nursing, and I'm wondering if there's ways where, as clinical practitioners, we can just be more educated in offering these modalities under our clinical license to patients, and also if there's space for educating our nurses, who are our first line of defense in the hospitals, to reconnect with these traditional nursing, how nursing was practiced. Can we educate nurses in integrating these therapies into their practice with the patients in the hospital? Is there space for that?
Well, the nursing staff is probably our primary allies and primary referral source. And Mass General, through the Institute for Health Professions, has a holistic nursing program. And a surprising number of nurses and nurse practitioners are also yoga teachers. So we have a nurse in our infusion unit who provides a class once a week to staff for stress management. So as much as we can, we do support our colleagues who are able to provide these services.
And are you finding that there's space to weave these things under a clinical license? I know it's tough with the insurance companies, but is there space for that?
In terms of other licensure, I can't comment on that. I know we do have an RN who provides some Reiki under her RN. We don't have Reiki provided by other than licensed professionals. So that can be done through the Therapeutic Touch program, but also through Reiki, and many nurses are doing that.
Okay, we have time for one last question, and then these folks will be around during our networking.
Hi, this question is for Dr. Leskowitz. I'm Nemanja Balatic. I'm a graduate researcher at MGH in the Division of Plastic Surgery. We're actually developing an integrative surgery program with Shriners Hospital for Children. Essentially, to optimize the whole process of wound healing, we're going to develop a protocol that includes nutrition, exercise, meditation, yoga, and an element of life purpose and meaning for kids that are undergoing this reconstructive process. The question is, what is your experience, because you said you did yoga with burn patients, with such a diverse population and also a diversity of injuries, what was your experience with having this practice?
Great question. Just to clarify, the Yoga for Burns program is just getting started now, so we don't have any reports on it. But you mentioned wound healing, and there's a very interestingly mixed literature on some of the therapeutic touch that was just mentioned. that there's some great potential for it, but actually the research foundation, one of the core key original research studies was fraudulent, in fact. And a couple of colleagues and myself had to do the unpleasant work of finding out that my favorite study to quote was bogus. But I do think that things like therapeutic touch, because of some of the Gronowitz's studies on fibroblasts and osteoblasts, in vitro growth being stimulated by therapeutic touch, I'd be glad to talk to you about it, but I would love to see something like that.
Yeah, definitely. Just because we're trying to include as many kids as possible, because you can easily say, you know, everybody that can ambulate fully, you know, that would include the patients that do yoga, but right. We want to include the kids that can do some minimal assisted activity to increase the population, so it'd be good to have that conversation. Thank you.
Sorry we have to stop. There's probably a lot of energy to say more. People are getting hungry. Then we have Helen. Helen.
So we're going to be breaking for lunch in just a minute, but a couple of important things before that. So before, when I showed you, okay, I was talking about our network map and how to register. So I just want to quickly show you how to register. So what you do is if you go, you can go to our website and oshercenter.org, and then there's the clinical network map here. You click on that. Or you can register by going to the, you can directly register from the register here, or you can click on the map and then register from the button from the map. The other thing that I'm just going to quickly demonstrate the registration form. It's very simple. You just enter your name and the type of services that you provide, your credentials, where you studied, what kind of degree you have, what kind of licensure, what are the certifications that pertain to your profession, whatever is relevant to your profession, and if you have whether or not you have an academic affiliation. That's very important because that's a requirement for the registration, and what is what institution you're affiliated with, and what is your title, meaning a title is perfectly fine to say acupuncturist, or if your title is, assistant professor someplace, and that's fine, whatever your professional title is. I also want to show you that you can register using your phones, so there's a couple of little tricks here. One is, so if you just go to, there's no app right now that's specific for this, so you just have to go to your internet, just type in oshercenter.org, you'll pull up the map, the same way you would do using a computer, and then in order to access the little menu of modalities that I was talking about here, you use the little menu bar on the left. If you click on that, then you'll see all the modalities. In order to see the map again, click the menu bar again. And the way to register using the phone is to go to this little pen icon on the right. That's how to register, and that'll take you to this screen. So it's a pretty nifty little tool. It's we're just launching it, so we would love to have your feedback as to what experience you have with it. And I really encourage you to go and talk with Clive Higgins, who's out there in the foyer, who's right at the big computer console. And if you have any questions as to how to register or how to use the mobile phone, if you have any issues, that he'll be able to help you with that during the poster session. So we're going to now break for lunch and posters. Please go visit the posters. And I want you also to thank all the people who filled our pre-event surveys. These were very important in planning this event. You're going to be receiving a post-event survey, and I really encourage you to give us your feedback. There are a lot of you gave us feedback last time, and that was very, very helpful. Now, I want to acknowledge, and I'm not sure she's going to be able to come here, but our program manager, Adara Nusrat, very, very, very important. So I think Adara is in the middle of something right now, but I want to tell you two things. This is the second conference now. Adara also organized our 2014 forum, and she had only been on board with us for a few months when she did the first conference. This time, she started planning this conference back last winter, and in the middle of this, she had a baby. So I know she's not here right now, but she'll be able to see this on the tape, okay? And I really want her to know how much we appreciate all the work she just put. And I mean, both conferences, I have to say, just went flawlessly. So I'm really, really grateful to her. So please. So please enjoy the networking and the posters, and we hope to see you at the next one.